that offer of, you know, free advice of attending as PSA is frankly, it's legally meaningless as far as we are concerned. So counsel for the first respondent is not seeking to withdraw a witness statement. Counsel is simply announcing at the end of the case for the petitioner that first respondent is not going to call the witness who had submitted a witness statement. That's the chairperson or first respondent who submitted a witness statement, who is a returning officer for the presidential election, and the constitutionality of whose declaration is at the heart of this case. Indeed, issue number two that your lordship set down for determination in the petition reads whether or not, based on the data contained in the declaration of the first respondent for the Well, that is a certified true copy. So my lord, let me proceed, and we can later sort out what is missing. I think the point I'm making is quite clear, that the issue number two, whose formulation will be clarified in due course, that issue relates to what was done in the declaration on the 9th of December. There's only been one declaration. That issue relates to that declaration. And eventually we may come back to a formulation of that. So it is the constitutionality of that declaration that is at the heart of this case. And that is reflected in issue number two. And in our respectful submission, what is being put before you now is not only an affront to justice, but it is not in accordance with the rules of this court, and we respectfully submit it must not be countenanced by this court. Now, counsel seeks to rely on Order 36, Rule 4.3, and also CI 87, and then eventually the Evidence Act. And I wish to go through those provisions. CI 47, Order 36, which counts, as was rightly pointed out, it counts in a part of the rule, the order, which is headed Order of Speeches. And the headnote, for what it's worth, says Order of Speeches. Rule 4.3 provides quite simply, where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence, where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence, the defendant may, after the close of the plaintiff's case, open the case of the defendant, and after the evidence on behalf of the defendant has been given, close the defendant's case, at the close of which the plaintiff may make a speech in reply. Now, my lord, it is clear that in that provision, it goes beyond just order of speeches and so on, which is the point I was making that yesterday. But yes, but my lord, we are dealing with Order 36.4.3, and I'm submitting that if you look at the dispositive part, of that Rule 4.3 makes it clear that that rule has nothing to do with what is being proposed before you. That Rule 4.3 is saying where the defendant elects to adduce, elects not to adduce evidence, then whether or not the defendant has, in the course of cross-examination of a witness or the plaintiff or otherwise, put in a document, the plaintiff may, after the evidence on behalf of the plaintiff has been given, close the plaintiff's case. And the defendant may then state the case of the defendant. Well, that's all that that provision says. The plaintiff may close, and the defendant may then state the case of the defendant. Now, my lord, what this is dealing with in the context of a civil trial, it's obvious. What it is dealing with is that when we announce that we close our case, when we do that, this is saying that if the defendant elects not to adduce evidence, then in effect they come first. They come first in the order of address. That essentially is what this is doing. They come first in addressing the court about their case, so they may state the case. That's what this is dealing with. This
is when you say they come first, do you mean the plaintiff or the defendant comes
first? The defendant comes first.
Okay.
That is what this provision is saying. In the event that they elect not to adduce evidence. Now, my lords, this provision cannot be the pretext for what counsel for the first respondent seeks to do, namely preventing cross-examination of a witness who has already submitted a witness statement before this court. And that witness statement was submitted submitted on the 22nd of January 2021 based on the orders of this court at the case management stage. It's our respectful submission that by filing its witness statement, the first respondent has clearly caused the breach as far as opening the witness up for cross-examination is concerned. That bridge has been crossed. That ship has already sailed. My lords, in determining issues regarding leave for serving interrogatories on first respondent.
Please, Mr. Chikata, before you have referred us to order 36, before you go on,
yes, my lord,
I want you to read order 38, rule 3E, sub rule 5. Of CI 47 as amended by CI 87. That is in respect of written statements. Order 38, that is in respect of witness statements. Order 38, rule 3E, sub rule 5. You can read sub rule 1 before you go and read sub rule 5, then you appreciate the import of the rule. Of CI 47 as amended by CI 87.
Order 38, rule 1,
rule 3E,
3E 1,
rule 3E 1 and 5, rule 3E,
yes,
sub rule 1 and then sub rule 5, that's the CI, it is,
yes, 3E 1,
yes.
If a party has served a witness statement, and that party wishes to rely at the trial on the evidence of the witness who made the statement, that party shall call the witness to give oral evidence, unless that party shall call the witness to give oral evidence, unless the court otherwise orders. Or that party puts a statement in, that party puts it in as hearsay evidence. So in fact, it is that party. Yeah, but my lord, let's be just clear about what one says, because one does not advance anything as far as, but
you find in addition, so that
now lie reads. Five reads, if a party who, I'm sorry, is it five or three? If a party who has served a witness statement does not call the witness to give evidence at the trial or put the witness statement in as hearsay evidence, any other party may put the witness statement in as hearsay evidence. Now, my lord, this is why I was going to advert your minds to various statements made in affidavits of the chairperson of the first respondent in connection with that very matter. And my lord, I believe that if you will allow me to proceed with the order of my submissions, I will explicitly address whatever concerns you have about CI 87 and its impact. Because, my lord, we're dealing with a situation here where, in determining the issues regarding leave for serving interrogatories on the first respondent, the fact that what was in the interrogatories could be the subject of cross-examination was a critical aspect of what was urged on the court by first respondent. There was an affidavit filed on 22nd January January 2021 by the chairperson in opposition to a motion for review of the court's refusal to allow for interrogatories to be searched. And this is what she says in paragraph 7. The applicant, referring to the applicant for review, the applicant does not suffer any injury at all to his rights, either paragraph 7. The applicant does not suffer any injury at all to his rights if the court dismisses the review application, as he still has the opportunity to solicit the answers he seeks during cross-examination, if he so wishes. This is the chairperson in her affidavit, stating that the applicant does not suffer injury, as he still has the opportunity to solicit the answers he seeks during cross-examination, if he so wishes. There is another affidavit on the 25th of January 2021 by the same chairperson, 25th of January 2021, by the same chairperson of the first respondent, in an affidavit in opposition to a motion for stay of proceedings. And there she states in paragraph 5 as follows: the petitioner does not suffer any injury at all to his rights if the court dismisses this application, as the petitioner will still have the opportunity to solicit the answers he seeks during cross-examination, if he so wishes. These are statements of the chairperson, who is now seeking to evade being cross-examined. And She puts the first respondent puts it beyond doubt that she herself knew that cross-examination was imminent in terms of the processes of the court. So our submission is that the combination of the filing of the statement, so it is a combination of the filing of the statement and the clear statements in the affidavits that we are quoted from, that makes clear her own intimation to this court that she would be subjecting herself to cross-examination. That is clear in her own words, under her own hand. And my lord,
can't she change her mind?
Well, my lord, there ought to be good reason. There ought to be good reason for changing her mind. And my lord, indeed, my lord, if she changes her mind, that should be openly put to this court, and the court may have power to disallow that change. Yes, my lord, and I will, my lord, if your lordship will allow me to, because.
Are you implying that by this affirmance in the affidavit, she's stopped from saying that she will not give evidence? Is that your
argument? That is correct.
That is the argument.
Yes. She has made representations to this court and to other parties in this case, specifically to the petitioner. She has made those representations. And she cannot now resign from those representations, unless there's good reason. My lord, I will come to the issue. Where there is good reason for anything, the court, as your lordship did when there was paragraphs 1 to 17, when it was okay, where there is good reason for something to be done, of course the court.
Mr. Keta, there's good reason there, but there's no good reason here.
That is what I'm submitting, because it has not even been put forward to you. In that particular case, the good reason was because the witness himself had noticed that there was a mistake in the statement of truth. The statement of truth is basically a format, you know, from the solicitor's office. And the witness had signed the 1 to 32. He had not signed the statement of truth, but the statement of truth made a reference to paragraphs 1 to... So, I made an application for an amendment. So, that is a completely different situation from what we have...
Mr. Kikata, 1 minute.
Yes.
Is there a reason why a witness will mount the witness books?
Yes, my lord. There's a lot of reason.
Yes.
Especially when that witness is the declaring officer.
I'm not even narrowing down to the first respondent.
No,
in this whole hearing, because witnesses file statement and we don't take them on the face of its value, they have to mount the witness box, swear an affidavit to the effect that what is contained in my witness statement, you know, if they, you know, until that is done. Otherwise, as soon as you file a witness statement, then you go on.
No, examining. My lords, we're dealing with the specific circumstances of an election petition under the terms of CI 99, which your lordships have sometimes used to strike down the operation of CI 47.
That this is a case that is different from all other cases.
Your lordships have said so, that CI 99.
But what is there in CI 99 that suggests that witness statements automatically become statements on oath?
There is in fact nothing in CI 99 about witness statements, as your ladyship knows. There is nothing about witness statements. This is being imported from CI 47, and that's part of the issue that we're having.
And so that makes witness statements automatically statements on oath?
My Lord, the tenor of the witness statement, as well as the answer in an election petition. My Lord, in a normal statement of claim in a high court, you don't have the plaintiff having to sign and having to verify in an affidavit. You don't have that.
But in matrimonial petitions,
yes,
you do.
Yes.
This is just a different form, and that is replicated along the journey. If along the journey of commencing cases, some come in originating motions, some come in petitions, some come by writ. Each one has its character. That's all. Well,
that's not all. Your lordships have said otherwise. Your lordships have said that an election petition under CI 99 has special characteristics, and that is part of...
Yeah, so Mr. Keith, that change the law on witness statements. Because we know witness statements are potential evidence. Potential. That is why the statement of truth is there. But so long as it is not sworn, it's not a sworn statement, it can't be evidence.
My Lord,
you know, judicial decisions are based on evidence.
My Lord,
judicially taken, where the witness comes to the box and takes the oath.
My Lord, this is why I'm drawing your attention to the difference in the election petition case, where the answer, the petition and the answer are signed. In this case, the chairperson signed the answer and signed a statement of an affidavit of verification. And not only that, she also signed the witness statement with a statement of truth.
As a potential evidence.
It's not potential.
It is evidence.
My Lord, it is not potential evidence. And I shall...
They are generic forms.
Very well.
Yes. It's evidence.
My lord, that's not what we need. We ought to agree whether the filing of a witness statement means an election to adduce evidence. That's what we need to agree on. An election to adduce evidence.
Look at.
Is it an election? That's what we have to agree on.
Can you look at the 38 rule 3E2?
Now, my lord, it would have been useful for me to respond to what they provide.
No.
And then you can put, but very well, 38.
The same rules that the 2. The same rules that we were earlier.
Okay. This is CI 87,
yes.
Very well.
38E3E2.
Now this is your lordship is going to CR 87.
Yes, it is.
And this is under general rule. Is that it?
No.
Use a trial of witness statements.
Please trial of witness statements. So let me read.
Page 4.
Where a witness is called to give oral evidence under sub-rule 1. The witness statement of that witness shall stand as the evidence in chief of that witness, unless the court otherwise orders.
Yeah.
So it is only when the person is called upon to give evidence that his witness statement becomes his evidence in chief.
My Lord,
the mere filing of a witness statement does not constitute evidence.
My Lord, it constitutes an election to adduce evidence. It is an election to adduce evidence. And what we are dealing with, my Lord, is very clear. Order 36, which they are relying on, it says where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence. And my submission has been that they elected by the witness statement, by the affidavits in which she said so and so, and I will quote more affidavits of hers.
So it is
the election to adduce evidence.
We are not doing trial by witness statement. The defendant comes to court.
My Lord.
Mr. Chair, please. The defendant comes to court and he says that he himself is going to testify and call 5 witnesses.
At the end of plaintiff's case,
he decides that
my Lord, I'm not going to need evidence. Neither am I going to call witnesses. My Lord, he be barred from saying so. Because he has initially informed the court that he himself was going to testify and call five witnesses.
My Lord, that is why I said that it depends on the context. In this case, we're dealing with a context of an election petition with its characteristics, and we are saying respectfully that in the context of the election petition,
yes,
where the petitioner has put in a petition, the petitioner has put in a statement of verification, an affidavit of verification,
yes,
you have the answer, and this chairperson signs the answer on behalf of the first respondent, and so, after signing that, she also signs a number of affidavits.
So, Mr. Shikata, so the petitioner in this case has signed a petition.
Yes.
Can he be compelled to come and give evidence?
The petitioner.
Who will compel him? He has almost deposed all the affidavits from, yeah,
but
from
my Lord, that is not the point. Who is going to compel him?
What is good for the government?
The petitioner issued the petition. Filed a witness statement.
No.
Has the petitioner filed a witness statement?
He has filed a petition. He has deposed several affidavits. Can we compel him?
The petitioner has not filed a witness statement.
What is more grave than a petition? Mr. Gita, what is more great? What is more serious than a pleading and a witness?
My Lord, it's not a question of what is more serious. It's a question of what the rule says. The rule says where the defendant elects not to
address. Yes, but I'm saying that. You are addressing us. Yes. You've referred to several affidavits imposed by,
yes,
the chairperson or the first respondent.
Yes.
Mr. Kita, I'm saying that in the same vein, the petitioner has deposed to several affidavits before us, but we cannot compel him.
In no affidavit of the petitioner does she say what I'm going to be subjecting myself to cross-examination, and therefore you don't need to serve the interrogatories. Nowhere has she done as a
petitioner.
Well, can I answer one at a time?
Very, very well, very well, very well.
Yes, my Lord, the petitioner has nowhere said that I am going to present myself to cross-examination and then resile on that. The petitioner has never said that. In fact, the petitioner has not filed a witness statement. The petitioner is relying on his witnesses, which is entirely allowed. So, my Lord, nobody can compel him to come and say. And the point that I was making in respect of what is in the affidavits of this chairperson is that she herself, in opposing an application in respect of serving on her interrogatories, she deposes to the fact that she is in effect going to be available to be cross-examined. She says that. I read the affidavit. There's nothing equivalent to that in the affidavits of the petitioner. Nothing. And there cannot be a legitimate comparison between the status of the petitioner and the status of the chairperson on the basis of that. That thing cannot happen. The logic of the situation should compel us to only one conclusion. The affidavits that I'm reading, and I will read some more affidavits of hers before I'm done, those affidavits state clearly her disposition to be cross-examined. And she uses that as a basis for opposing the leave for interrogatories application. She uses that. So you can't discount that. And nothing that the petitioner has done in an affidavit, nothing compares to that.
But so Mr. Skata, all that I'm saying is this. If a party comes to court and informs the court that he's going to give evidence himself and all three witnesses, and later on, he changes his mind that because of certain things that have happened, I don't intend to lead evidence. Neither do I intend to call witnesses. Is the party banned? Can the court compel that because of the statement that he made?
My Lord,
can he be compelled to testify My Lord, what I've stated clearly is that Order 36, Rule 4.3 is clear in itself. Where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence and so and so. And my Lord, I have said that in this case, this respondent, this first respondent, has elected. And he's elected both by filing the witness statement and also he's elected by her affidavit in which she was rejecting our request for certain information to be provided by her, and she was in effect saying to us, wait, when I'm being cross-examined, you can put it to me. That's the effect of what she says in her witness, in her affidavits. That's the effect.
So you can't change his mind.
My Lord, that's why I said if she changes her mind, there are proper ways to effect that. At the moment, we do not have that situation. And my Lord, I will respectfully further indicate that the dispositive part of Order 26, Rule 4.3 has nothing to do with what is being done before you. That dispositive part just says the plaintiff may, after the evidence on behalf of the plaintiff has been given, close the plaintiff's case, and the defendant may then state the case of the defendant. That's the dispositive part. It has nothing to do with what has been done.
I think my brother or my wife referred earlier on to Order 38, Who deals specifically with witness statements? And the interpretation that we can put on is that witness statement.
Yes, my Lord, the fight.
So the witness has gone to the witness box and taking the judicial oath.
My Lord, with respect. With respect, that is an erroneous interpretation.
No.
With respect, that what that rule reads, if a party who has served a witness statement does not call the witness to give evidence at the trial, or put the witness statement in as hearsay evidence, any other party may put the witness statement in as hearsay. So the dispositive part of that is any other party may put the witness statement in as hearsay evidence. That's the dispositive part.
So it allows to call a witness who have filed a witness statement.
Oh my Lord, that cannot be the proper interpretation. It said, if a party who has served the witness statement does not call the witness to give, my Lord,
and please, Mr. Kikata, in your weight, you know, really four, the number of witnesses that the petitioner intends to call, five. Eventually, you call
two,
and then with leave of the court, you add one. But were you going to insist that because it's written in your weight that you call five witnesses, go and bring the five witnesses?
No, my Lord, that is not the same. So we are not five witness statements. We have not filed five witness. No, the matter is very clear. We have not filed five witness statements. So that analogy does not hold.
But I've already told you that, yes, the witness statement may be filed. But until the witness enter into the witness box and swear an oath, it is not evidence yet.
My Lord, this is not the position that was taken by the Supreme Court in a case Sumaila Bill versus Adamu Dramani and the Attorney General. That position that your ladyship has expressed was not the position taken.
May I?
It is, as far as I know, it's unreported. It's written number
so three. It's reported.
Very, very well. I don't have the report, but I have the ruling. My Lord, may I read from, may I read, yes, but my Lord, may I read and then we can discuss what the impact of CIT 7 is on that matter.
Okay, so read number J1/2/2010. The ruling is delivered on 23rd. Yes, my lord, it's 2012.
Yeah.
One Supreme Court of Ghana, the law reports at 370. I'm well aware that CI-87 was not enforced at that time, but CI-47 was enforced. And my lord, the portion of his lordship justice, and my lord, it was a panel that consisted of Dr. Datsebawan, Justice of the Supreme Court, and Sir Adinya Owusu, Miss Doche, Yaboa JSC, as your lordship then was, as you were then, Bafo Boni JSC, Badegbe, and Akuto Bamfo. And my lord, this is what, the series of these cases, that report, the law report that I referred to, refers to another of the Bill Bill cases.
Your lordship, you know, there's a series of
bills. So, my lord, let me stick with my writ number J1/2/2010, a decision delivered on the 23rd of May 2012. And in that, this is what Doctor.
The
citation is 374 rather than 370. If we're taking it from the Supreme Court. 174/2012. And this is what Dr. Datsebawan says in the ruling of the court, which included your lordship, the Chief Justice. It is a unanimous view of this court that the first defendant, Adamu Dramani, should be called upon to open his defense in the interest of justice. This case does not have the ordinary characteristics of a trial, say at the High Court. The procedure before this court is such that before the commencement of oral testimony in this case, the first defendant had already put matters in evidence by affidavit. In this circumstance, it is artificial and hardly sustainable to disregard the evidence already adduced by the affidavit of the first respondent and proceed to an assessment of a no-case submission made on his behalf as if the only evidence on record is that of the plaintiff. So, my lord,
Mr. Chikata, please, we are dealing with witness statement, which is not sworn. We are talking about an affidavit that is sworn.
And I refer to
it's affidavit evidence. I refer to witness statement cannot be evidence. That is where we depart.
My lord,
affidavit is evidence because it is sworn by before the commission of court.
My lord,
and witness statements are not sworn.
My lord, in this case, witness statements are also verified as documents of truth.
So,
yes, but
that, lord, that is why we are lying.
My lord, yes, but my lord, I refer to affidavits sworn to by the chairperson. I refer to affidavits. No, my lord, the ruling of this court.
Because the issue between you and me in particular is that, as far as for me,
as far as
we take the judicial oath, the oath to speak the truth, for him, for her, to be cross-examined, for the witness statement to be adopted as evidence in chief, that document is just a potential evidence. It is not proper evidence before this court because it's not an oath.
My lord,
rely on it.
My lord, that evidence indicates an election to adduce evidence. My lord, that is what I'm submitting.
So it is evidence.
It, it,
it's an election. My Lord, I'm saying that
okay.
The rule that we're dealing with talks about election to adduce evidence. I'm saying it's an election to adduce evidence. So my Lord cannot keep going back to the issue of whether it has been sworn or not, because the orders that we are dealing with, according to the argument of counsel for the first respondent, is an order where he is reading where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence. That is the material basis on which he is putting forward his submissions to you. And your lordships are taking me away from the language of that order where you elect to adduce evidence, and your lordships are going into an issue of where he has called the evidence. But those are two different scenarios, because if he has elected by virtue of a witness statement and affidavits that he has filed, if he has clearly elected, then that order 26 rule 4-3 cannot apply because of his election. That's the point I'm making. So the dispositive part of 36 rule 4-3, that dispositive part, will not come into operation. And I'm saying further that in any case, that dispositive part of that order 36 rule 4-3 does not have the consequence that is attributing to it. And I'm further submitting that all these questions about whether this particular witness state, or whether in general terms a witness statement means that he cannot change his mind or not, all those do not address what the terms of Order 36 are, because Order 36 is talking about electing not to adduce evidence. Electing not to adduce.
May I seek a clarification? Maybe it will help us to move forward. So, if I understand your submission, it is that an election has to be made by the party.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your submission is that the first respondent made this election from when they filed the answer and other affidavits that they have introduced and things. So is for you
the witness statement.
Yes, the witness statement. And I then say that the key issue is what constitutes the election and at what time can it be made?
Absolutely.
And can what the first respondent is doing now constitute an election now rather than the previous thing? That seems to me to be the issue that we have.
I agree 100% that is the issue before us. And my lord, what I'm submitting is that as at the time when this application was put before you yesterday, as at that time, the election that had been made was contrary to that precondition in Order 36, Rule 4-3. Because that condition said, where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence. And by that time, when he got up to say what he said, they had already elected to adduce evidence. That is my submission. That is, well, my lord, that determination has to be made on facts. And the facts that are before all of us in plain view are that they have filed a witness statement, the chairperson, and she has filed various affidavits in which she says she is offering herself for cross-examination basically on the assumption, and not an assumption, she's actually saying, I don't want to have to answer interrogatories because I'm available for cross-examination. That's what she's saying. And I'm saying that affidavit upon affidavit, which deposes to that, affidavit upon affidavit, which deposes to that,
constitute representations of her election to testify, her election to undergo cross-examination. That is my submission. Yes.
The point I needed or wanted to you to address is the point at which witness statements are filed. It is done at the case management stage, when the court directs that parties should file their witness statements. This case management stage is a process for ensuring that the case can move expeditiously. Is that not the situation? So, with that direction, following that, no party can change their mind.
No, they can ask for leave to. They can ask for leave where they ask, where they need to change their mind. They can ask for leave.
Thank you.
In this case, we do not have an application for leave. In this case, prior to what was represented to you yesterday, as at the time that my learned friend got up to make his submissions, as at that time, my submission is that there had been an election to do the opposite of the precondition in Order 36, Rule 4-3, where the defendant elects not to adduce evidence. And respectfully, all the material that is before this court, in plain view, as I indicated, all that material is that there was an election to testify. There was an election to adduce evidence. And that was also included. That was also included. My Lord, another significant passage in the decision in Biobio and Dramani is the passage at page 377, where after referring to the English authorities, including Alexander and Raytheon. Can I have back my... Yeah, okay. Where after referring to Alexander and Raytheon, in particular, the passage where the court has said that it is not right that the judge of fact should be asked to express any opinion upon the evidence until the evidence is completed. His Lordship, Justice Dattebayo, continues, similarly, it is an inherently difficult exercise to ask this court in this case, to disregard evidence put in place by the first defendant's affidavit and to rule on his submission of no case as if the only evidence on record is that of the plaintiff. That is why we consider that the interest of justice would be best served by hearing whatever evidence the first defendant wishes to offer in his defense. The interest of justice would be best served by hearing whatever evidence the first defendant wishes to offer in his defense. This court can then make up its mind in relation to all the facts at the end of the trial. My lords, respectfully, this wisdom of His Lordship Justice Jatevan is particularly germane to this case, where it is the chairperson of the Electoral Commission is not only the returning officer, but in whose bosom resides the basis on which he made a declaration. It is in nobody else's bosom, not even in the bosom of your lordships. It's the law that is in your bosom, but in respect of the declaration, your lordships, it is only in her bosom that the basis of the declaration can be found. And so, when she has elected to give evidence before you, we cannot have a misapplication of Order 36, Rule 4, 3 as a reason for her not doing what she has told us in a sworn affidavit she's ready to do. She cannot do that. The God whose glory she announced she was doing what she was doing is a God of truth. And therefore, my lords, it is important to bear in mind what Justice Dattebar said. And in this particular case, he actually goes on to cite what he calls the sound advice of Lord Justice Simon Brown in the Benham case cited above, where he says, "Let me state my central conclusion as emphatically as I can. Rarely, if ever, should a judge trying a civil action without a jury entertain a submission of no case to answer." That clearly was the court's conclusion in Alexander and Raisin, and I see no reason to take a different view today, the CPR notwithstanding. Almost without it, and that is a reference to the CPR, of course, in England. Almost without exception, the dangers and difficulties involved will outweigh any supposed advantages. Any temptation, that's the last word, any temptation to entertain a submission should almost invariably be resisted. Now, my lords, it is therefore my submission submission is that exactly as in the BOBL decision of the Supreme Court, the interest of justice at a minimum required this court to do exactly what was done in the BOBL case.
Sorry for interrupting your submission. In that case, if my memory serves me right, we have come to court and made a submission of no case. What we read was a ruling. In this case,
there's no submission of
yes. They are opting. It's an option. They are electing not to give evidence. So let us be very clear.
Yes, my lords. My lords, I am very clear in my mind about what happened in the BOBL case. I'm very clear in my mind about that. And I'm very clear in my mind that in that case, the plaintiff went to court seeking an enforcement of a provision of the Constitution in respect of the eligibility of Yes. And my lords, in that case, as your lordship rightly said, there was a submission of no case. But my lords, the reason, the ratio decidendi of that case, in my respectful submission, is based on what the interests of justice require, where a plaintiff has been posed to an affidavit. And in that case, it was only one affidavit. And their lordships were saying, their lordships, including your lordship, the Chief Justice, said clearly in that case that in the interest of justice, the defendant should testify. That's what your lordship said. And I'm respectfully submitting that that ratio is a ratio that is worth applying in the circumstances of this case. The only difference in the circumstances of this case is that they are relying on Order 36 Rule 43. And in my submission, that Order 36 Rule 43 does not lead to what they are asking for, because
I want to correct this. They are relying on Order 36 and Order 38. Please don't leave Order 38 out, because Order 36 has nothing to do with witness statements. Order 38 is specific. Specifically drafted for witness statements, and you are avoiding that.
My lord, I am not avoiding that. My lord, if your lordships are with me that Order 36 Rule 43 is irrelevant, then my lords, I will indeed address directly what your lordship is claiming that I'm avoiding. I cannot be said to be avoiding it when I referred your lordships to that Rule 5, and I said respectfully that the interpretation that your lordship was putting on that was not, I believe I responded to that. So how can your lordship on the other side say that I didn't respond, I'm avoiding 38.5? I responded to your lordship directly. My lord, I don't think it's fair to me to be making that sort of observation.
Another defense.
But my lord, can my position be accepted that I responded to
yes,
your lordship?
You did.
Yes. So how can my lord say that I'm avoiding a particular provision? That's not right.
Yeah. Look at that. I just want to draw another significant difference in the case you cited, the Bible, the Bill case, is that that dealt with affidavits. That dealt with affidavits. The court dealt with affidavits, which are generally evidence, because they are sworn. But in this case, we are not dealing with affidavit. So that's another significant difference.
My Lord,
I wanted to...
My Lord, with the greatest respect, that is why I took the pains to refer to affidavits that are before you in these proceedings. In the same way as an affidavit was before the court in those proceedings, I have referred your lordship to affidavits which are before you in these proceedings.
But these affidavits are affidavits attached to applications.
Yes, but they are still before you. They are still before the court, my lord. I mean, affidavits attached to applications are before the court. Is that not our interlocutory? That is why when people say affidavit and say I refer to all the processes as if I included them in the affidavit, I mean, that is, I would have thought, the basic aspect of, the basic aspect of,
in writing a judgment,
in writing a judgment
or a ruling,
yes,
would a judge be right if the judge weren't referring to affidavits attached to applications,
my lord,
and left the record of the testimonies and the cross-examinations that the judge received? Would you, in writing a judgment, would a judge be right, ever right, in referring to affidavits attached to applications,
yes,
that have been completed?
Yes, my lord, the judge, I not ignore. I never said that they should ignore. I said that you can refer to those affidavits. My answer to your specific question, my lady, is that you can, for instance, if something that was in testimony is contradicted by something that she filed an affidavit, he filed an affidavit on oath, that is a matter that can be referred to, and that is a matter indeed upon which there can be cross-examination. There can be cross-examination on those matters.
Because that's mixing. That's totally mixing.
Totally what?
Mixing. If you have interlocutory applications and they're done with, you can't mix them with the evidence taken at trial.
Lord,
you know that.
It's not a question of mixing them. You always have available a record. And if in that record there are affidavits in which statements have been made, they are on oath, and you are entitled to refer to them. That's exactly what their lordships did. In that Bill case, it had not got to the, I mean, what was stated in the affidavit had not been stated in the witness box. What was stated in the affidavit had not been stated in the witness box.
It's a trial on affidavits. In the Bill case, trial on affidavits.
Yes, but that's what I...
So they were perfectly right. My laws were perfectly right.
Is your lordship saying that if the witness had gone into the witness box and had said something contrary to what they said in the affidavit, for instance, if the court had ordered that we want to hear you, just as the court ordered the defendant to go into the witness box, the court would have said, we want to hear your evidence in the witness box. Is your lordship saying that you cannot refer to that affidavit which is deposed?
No, even in the affidavit trial, a deponent can be ordered to appear. Because
examined,
so it's a trial.
That's what happened. But that is what happened.
Because that affidavit is evidence, so you can be cross-examined on it. But we are saying that in a witness statement, it is not yet evidence. That is where
my lord, I don't think the issue that we are dealing with right now should really be the issue of whether it is yet evidence, because I believe as.
That is agitating my mind. That is agitating my mind.
But
whether it is evidence or not,
and the
effort
is that order 34 as cited by counsel is not relevant in the current circumstances.
That's what you're saying. Is that what your ladyship is saying?
Stand you are saying.
That's what I've been saying.
Order 36.
And I believe that is what was summarized by
their lies. Different members of the bench are agitated by different things.
I am peaceful. And I'm seeking to address the different things.
Yeah.
Nice evening, and I appreciate the fact that your lordships are candid with your concerns. I appreciate that entirely. And so, my lords, the point I'm making, if we move to away from Order 36043, if we move from there into the question of what is the effect of a witness statement, which is what is agitating your lordship's mind. What is the effect of a witness statement prior to when it's when the witness actually goes into the witness box? And my lords, my submission on this is very straightforward. My submission on this is that your lordships made case management orders in this case in respect of how the case would proceed, including the witness statements and the witnesses. Now, my lords, it is my respectful submission that nowhere in either your case management orders or in CI 99, nowhere is there provision made for the procedure that my learned friends are seeking to adopt. Nowhere in the rules. Nowhere in the rules. Now, your lordships have been referring to Order 38.3 as amended in CI 87. And in that order, 38.3E, the provision again is very clear. If a party has served a witness statement and that party wishes to rely at the trial on the evidence of the witness who made the statement, that party shall call the witness if you wish to rely. That is why in my opening words, I said to your lordships, in my opening words, I said respectfully to your lordships, in my opening words, I said, this is not a situation in which counsel is seeking to withdraw the witness statement. I said that in my opening words. This is not a situation in which counsel is saying, I'm no more relying on my witness statement or my answer. And 38.3E says, if you are still wishing to rely at the trial on the evidence of the witness who made the statement, you shall call the witness. Mandatory terms. Mandatory. You shall call the witness. They have not said they are not relying on that witness statement. They have not said that. So, shall call is mandatory, the last time I checked in the law books. And my lords, I'm sorry.
As you were.
Yes, but my lords, ask that now. Nobody has said we don't intend to rely on the witness statement. Nowhere has it been stated. All they have said, is the reality. I mean, however much grumbling goes on the other side, the reality is that
ethics at the bar. Counselor is on his feet. He's addressing the bench. Please, please, please. You may take notes. You may hear him, but you don't have to make a noise at the background. Please, please, please.
So, my lords, I mean, if they do not intend to rely on the witness statement, they should say so. It's as simple as that. If they do not intend to rely on the witness statement.
My lord,
this is important. My lord, this is important because there are many options open to us. If they say they are not relying on the witness, we can apply to the court for a subpoena. to call the chairperson, for instance. We can apply to the court, yes, because the only reason why we did not take that cause is of course because she is acting on behalf of the first respondent. So it would be inappropriate to issue a subpoena on the opposite party whom she is representing.
I thought it was implied
by the application, by the nature of the
application. I thought it was implied that you did not want to rely on
the... As your lordship heard me from the opening paragraph or the opening sentences of my submission, I indicated what my understanding of what they had done was based on order 36, based on. And I did not hear, and I don't think that your lordship heard any differently, I did not hear at any point a statement that they had decided not to rely on the evidence of the witness. I did not hear that at any point. And my submission is that unless they give an indication, and if they give that indication, then there are other consequences, especially in terms of our case. Because once they give that indication, then it is open for us, for instance, to have her subpoenaed to testify as a public officer who holds certain records. It is open to us to do that. And my lord, this will not be contrary to any human rights of hers, because she has a constitutional duty that she is performing, and if she is called upon by a court to come and testify to the performance of that constitutional duty, that cannot be contrary to any human rights. In any case, if, for example, there was an attempt to suggest that the witness had some privilege, or, you know, wants to exercise a right to avoid self-incrimination, for instance, if the witness would have to give that indication. It cannot be assumed for her by anybody, least of all from the bench. It cannot be assumed that the witness has certain rights against self-incrimination, for instance, which she is wishing to exercise. Those are indeed human rights provisions, especially applicable in a criminal trial context. But whether or not they're applicable here, the witness is the one who has to invoke that particular claim of a privilege or right against self-incrimination or whatever. And that has not, as we speak, been the case that is before you. What is before you is order 36 rule 4, order 38 rule 3E and 5. I just read 3E, and clearly in my submission, until we have an indication that they do not intend to rely on that witness statement, and they then take the consequences of that, including consequences of what we are then able to do in terms of asking the court. The court may refuse it, but it will be entirely open to us to ask the court to take certain steps on account of what she said or what counsel says they are going to do. It is entirely open to us to take those steps after there is, if indeed that is the indication that is being given. Then I believe order 38 rule 3E5 I have addressed previously. So unless there is a specific question about any aspect of order 38 that, you know, I'm not avoiding, so I'm happy to have my attention drawn to any other aspects that I've not covered. But I believe I have covered all aspects of order 38 for 1B. Order 38, 3E, and 5. Now, my lords, as I've indicated, and I believe there was a question from the bench yesterday about whether these are not issues of human rights. And
I have an answer today.
My lords, you put that into an arena yesterday
And so I think it's useful that I make a specific. My Lord, I'm not ignoring what your Lord should say. I'm not used to that.
No, yesterday
I have a very, very well. Yes. Now, my Lord, it is therefore my respectful submission that in the situation that is before your lordships, what the clear interests of justice require is for your lordships not to allow the evasion by the chairperson from cross-examination. And my lords, this is particularly important because of the nature of the function of this particular witness. We are not dealing with a witness in a normal civil trial, where it is simply a matter of competing private interests. We're not dealing with that situation. We're dealing with a matter concerning the exercise of grave constitutional responsibilities by someone who has been duly appointed to a high office of state. And that person, in my respectful submission, has a constitutional duty to give an account of what she has done in the conduct of her responsibilities. Now, my lords, a particular responsibility that she is carrying out and for which she needs to give an account. The particular responsibility here is no less than the responsibility to declare who has, in accordance with the will of the people, been elected the president of Ghana. That is no mean duty. That is a duty of which this petition has been brought. And as I indicated, the issue two that your lordships have set down, that issue two speaks to the proper conduct of her responsibilities in making a declaration. And this petition is about her own declaration, which we all watched
At least we watch the part of it. And the petition is based on what she said. There has been no other declaration. And your lordships will note that in the affidavit, in the affidavit again, it's an affidavit that she filed in opposition to a motion on notice for leave to inspect documents, which was another application that we brought. In that affidavit, she states, among other things, in fact, from paragraph 8 of that affidavit, she says, Form 13 is generated from the summation of all the results in the presidential regional result summary sheet from 12. The petitioner has duplicate copies of the presidential result summary sheet from 12, as admitted by the two witnesses of the petitioner. Then paragraph 9, Form 13B was generated by the first respondent to aid the declaration of results. So, my lord, she is testifying in this affidavit to a number of important facts about what she did. Form 13B was generated by the first respondent to aid the declaration of results obtained by getting the results from the presidential regional result summary sheet from Form 12 for the 16 regions, in a way that does not materially affect the form substance and not calculated to mislead any person. Now, my lords, she goes on to say that apart from Form 13, yes,
in paragraph 7, she said,
I say that save for Forms 13 and 13B, which is attached to my witness statement filed on 22nd January 2021 as Exhibit 4, the petitioner already has in his possession, custody or power, duplicate copies of all the other forms and documents he is requesting to inspect, as same were given to him by his agent at the various courts. So the chairperson, on behalf of the first respondent, is acknowledging that save for Form 13 and 13B, which is attached to the witness statement, petitioner already has certain things in the possession, and she even seeks to quote, that Form 13B is a critical form for the exercise of her responsibilities, and she has to speak to that form. Indeed, your lordship heard testimony from the second witness of the petitioner to the effect that what was being claimed as Form 13 is not in compliance with what is in CI-127. The second witness of the petitioner stated that very categorically, that what was being offered as Form 13 was not compliant with the form that is Form 13 in CI-127. CI-127 is under the hand of the chairperson of the Electoral Commission. And there is evidence before your lordships that she did not even comply with the CI under her own hand. My lord, if the holder of such a public office cannot be held to account by being cross-examined after she herself has given a witness statement, then, my lords, with the greatest respect, we would be posing grave dangers to the Republic. Because the holders of important offices can shield themselves from accountability by saying in every case that we will not allow ourselves to be cross-examined and nobody can do anything about it.
And what I submitted earlier and which ties into this point that I'm making is that if it were not for the fact that she is the representative who has sworn a statement on behalf of the first respondent, it would be open to us to ask the court for a subpoena to have her testify. So my lords, we respectfully submit that in the circumstances that we are faced with here, with this particular holder of this particularly singular office that is supposed to make a determination that reflects the sovereign will of the voters of Ghana in an election, which is what democracy is all about. It is our respectful submission that that constitutional obligation cannot be set aside by subsidiary legislation or by reliance on subsidiary legislation. It cannot. Legislation that we've talked about, CR 87, CR 47, and I mean, none of that can set aside duty of this chairperson and the need to account for that public duty where the forum demands it. And my lords, this is a forum that demands it. My lord, reference has been made by my learned friend to the case of Hydro versus Hydrofor. That was indeed a Supreme Court decision in 2012. The decision led by Justice Bainin and a court that comprised various justices, including Your Lordship, the Chief Justice. Now, my lord, that case has absolutely no application to the circumstances that we are dealing with. Because in that case, what happened was that the parties had agreed that instead of testifying by themselves, they would both rely on the testimony of an expert, a surveyor. And on appeal, the point was raised that the plaintiff himself ought to have testified and not rely on the evidence of the expert. Within that context, the parties have agreed that we're going to rely on an expert because this is a matter on which an expert can resolve the issue between us. We don't need to be sort of testifying and, you know, we are not the expert. We rely on an expert. The parties have agreed that. Then they go to court, and one party is more or less arguing that because the plaintiff did not testify, it should be held against him. My lords, of course, rejected that argument, and my lords made it clear that you can't compel a party to a suit to testify. That has nothing to do with the situation that we're dealing with here. And the court said, in Bainin's judgment, page 1563 to 1564, in the instant case, the issue agreed upon was the value of the land
The trial judge considered it required expert evidence to assist him to determine it. The parties appear to have agreed with that position taken by the trial judge. So apart from the fact that they did not challenge it, neither of them gave evidence by themselves. They all deferred to expert evidence. The plaintiff relied on the evidence of the expert nominated and appointed by the court with the party's consent. The defendant went further to call three other witnesses, in, three other experts in land valuation. It is in that context that the Lordship said, a party does not need to call evidence by himself. Where the issue to be resolved is of such a nature that expert evidence would, I think it should be B, but it says that would the best evidence, would, I think B is missing from the report. Expert evidence would be the best evidence required to assist the tribunal of fact to resolve the issue, or where expert evidence is dispositive of the issue. That is what Hydrophones, Kibama and Hydrophone is about. That case has no application to the circumstances that we're dealing with here. The circumstances that we're dealing with here is of somebody who has elected to testify and who has notified of that election not only by submitting a witness statement but also in affidavits that he has filed. But look, if we didn't take her affidavit seriously, then it would almost be as if she's taunting us and saying, you know, I am prepared to give evidence. She's taunting us with that. And she's using that to get a decision in her favor on interrogatories. Once that decision is given, then she now says, no more, I'm not giving evidence. You served in opposition to an application for leave for interrogatories. You, the holder of that important constitutional office, you said, I'm going to be available to be cross-examined. On that basis, among other things, the lordships have made a ruling allowing you not to have to answer interrogatories. Then, after you got that decision, you now ignore the things that you said in your affidavits,
and you come and your counsel is saying to the court, I'm not going to put you in the witness box.
Obviously, the interrogatories process that we filed was meant to help us in the conduct of our case. And what they filed by way of witness statements and so on was again meant to help us in the conduct of our case. So once they filed and gave an indication that she was going to testify, and she herself gave that indication in our affidavits, why not? Our options in terms of her being called to account for her constitutional duty, our options were entirely non-existent. Our options were to calmly wait for her to come into the witness box for cross-examination. We had no other option. We had no other option, and we still have no other option because it has not been said at any point to your lordships that they are not relying on that witness statement. It has not been said. Now, my lords, another decision was cited, I believe. Yes, this is a... This is the Akuno, Bafo, and Lawrence Boaku case. And my lord, part of the problem that I see in respect of what we are faced with is that on the one hand, they are saying that they are not making a submission of no case. Then on the other hand, they are talking about burden of proof. My lord, the burden of proof can only be relevant if
if we are talking about a submission of no case. Because otherwise, why are we discussing burden of proof? I mean, burden of proof has no relevance at this point. If all we are talking about is order 36, rule 4, 3, and so on, burden of proof has absolutely no relevance. In any case, the authority that was cited, Ms. Joseph, Akno, Bafo, and Lawrence Waku, significantly, when counsel himself was reading from the passage that he read from, the lordships talked about the shifting of the evidential burden, the shifting of the burden which depends on the stage that the case is at. And my lord, I'm really reluctant to go into the issue of burden of proof at this point because I think it's irrelevant. But because it has been raised, I'm obliged to point out why it is irrelevant. Because if your lordship look at the Evidence Act from section 10, and my lord, I will not read the section, but from section 10 to